you're going to have to come back to the table with $4 trillion worth of cuts, like it or no. You cannot let your borrowing requirement get out of hand, and your ratio of GDP to debt is just getting ridiculous, as many of the European countries are. I feel absolutely passionate about this for the simple reason that I believe excessive debt could lead to the demise of democracy. I think it's that bad.
A profound statement following up on now what we have, the super committee that's going to try to figure out what to do with some of this debt. That was David Buick, by the way. He's a market analyst. He's been watching the financial world for 49 years, and he really got us thinking, and certainly a lot of reaction from you, the viewers. Could the debt problems that we're experiencing right now lead to the end of some democracies, maybe our own, maybe others? So we're going to talk about it. Sam Chandon is president of Chandon Economics and a professor at the Wharton School of Business. Peter Schiff is president of Euro Pacific Capital, also author of How an Economy Grows and Why It Crashes. And Larry Glaser is managing partner with Mayflower Advisors. Welcome to you all, gentlemen. It's a big topic, and we have a few minutes to try to figure out if we're going to see the demise of democracy. So good luck to us all, right? Peter, do you think there's a link here? A lot of debt will lead to the destruction of democracy?
Well, absolutely. You know, the framers of our Constitution warned about the perils of democracy when they established our country. That's why we were established as a republic with a lot of safeguards to protect us from democracy. Unfortunately, a lot of those safeguards have been removed. And the problem is politicians, to get elected, promise people something for nothing. And we have created a dependent class, but we have borrowed all sorts of money to provide for it. Europe has made the same mistakes. And when you compound that with the fact that the U.S. and Europe, we decided, unfortunately, to bail out all the banks after the financial crisis, and now we assumed all that debt on top of the debt from the social welfare states, and governments are broke, and they have to level with the with the public and tell them that the gravy train is over. That's happening in Europe now. It's going to happen here in the United States, and I am afraid that we're going to have some very violent reactions by people in this country when they lose that something for nothing. And who knows what's going to happen? And, you know, we lose a lot of rights when there's a crisis. We lost a lot of rights following September 11th.
Sure.
We're losing rights following the financial crisis. But when things really get bad, when there's shortages, when people don't have enough food, when they don't have enough power, when the dollar collapses and people are rioting, who knows what the government is going to do?
You know, it's interesting you mentioned the founding fathers, Peter. And Larry, I'd like you to weigh in on this.
Sure.
Because one of the things that we saw in, well, when we became a nation back during the American Revolution, here's a little dose of history. Some of our founding fathers had to go out and get credit lines from other countries like France and from the Dutch, because that legitimized the country, that we had a credit line, that we had debt. And still to this day, people are buying our debt. So in some ways, sure, does the debt still legitimize us as a sovereign nation? Because out of all the debt that's out there, people are still buying ours.
Sure. Well, I think what you find here is that certainly events always appear their darkest before dawn. And when we look specifically at the U.S. debt downgrade by Standard & Poor's, what we see is many investors might interpret that as the end of the empire. In fact, that may actually be the beginning of the recovery, the beginning of the restructuring that needed to happen all along that never happened. This is the beginning of the political cover that Washington needed to make the reforms and the hard decisions that are necessary. So I view this as an opportunity. You know, Jenna, it's interesting. When we look at what the unfounded fear-mongering that came about the S&P downgrade, investors said credit card rates would soar and mortgage rates would soar and car loans would be unavailable. In fact, we haven't seen any of that. We've seen rates come down. We haven't seen any absence of liquidity. And we find that investors may interpret this data. Well, Peter, we do see a weak dollar. You're right. But that's good for U.S. companies, isn't it?
No, it's lousy for U.S. companies. It means it costs more to produce. It means raw materials get more expensive. It means imported components get more expensive. And it means there's no capital to invest because the capital is fleeing the weak dollar. Look, temporarily, you got a flight into treasuries. But pretty soon, our creditors are going to realize that you can't seek a safe haven from treasuries in treasuries. Foreign central banks are going to stop buying
our bonds. Peter, when we look at the pillars of the U.S. economy,
let me just jump in here, guys, just for a second here, because I'd like to get Sam involved as well. You're talking about a lot of different market components, Sam, but I'd like to bring up something that we saw over the last couple weeks. Let's bring up the new cover for Time magazine and check this out, if we can show everybody, because it shows the rioting that's happening, and it asks the question, the decline and fall of Europe, and in quotations, you can't see it very well, it says, and maybe the West. Sam, is it really about the economy here? I mean, when we're talking about the demise of democracy, is it really just about the economy that can cause it, or is there other things that we should consider?
I think there are a couple things going on here, Jenna. Certainly, you know, the situation with our debt, whether it be in Europe or the United States, is one that will prove to be extraordinarily challenging for us in requiring us to make some very difficult choices as we look forward. How are we going to restructure our economies? How are we going to restructure our debt? And in as much as, at least in the United States, we don't see policymakers working together in a way that is leading to some of those positive developments, there's naturally an extraordinary degree of frustration amongst people who are very engaged in the political process. Does that necessarily mean that we ultimately face a situation where voters will disengage in a way that means the end of sort of citizen participation?
Sure.
And I think we don't. I think if anything, the signals are that while voters are frustrated, while citizens are not necessarily clear about how to direct that frustration, we see that playing out certainly in London, where it's, you know, misdirected, undirected. That doesn't necessarily mean that we're headed down a path where ultimately we devolve into chaos. We've seen in the past many countries that have gone through times of extraordinary economic turbulence only to emerge stronger. And what I'd suggest also, Jenna, is that even in countries where we see very significant income constraints in the emerging economies, democracy can take hold, it can take root, and it can thrive.
Peter,
remember, you know,
go ahead, Peter.
Yeah, in this case, democracy is the problem because our leaders want to get reelected. And so they don't want to do what's right for the country.
Would you offer
they
a different system, though, Peter? I mean, is it a choice between democracy or something else?
If we can go back to a Republican government the way the framers envisioned it, if we went back to real money, if we were still on a gold standard like we were supposed to be, we wouldn't have all this debt. But the problem is we have voted ourselves into bankruptcy, and our elected leaders want to stay there. They don't want to be honest with the American public. They don't want to level with them and tell them that they have to stop spending and start saving, that we have to start producing and just not consuming, and that we can't have all these entitlements that have been promised. We can't have all the welfare benefits, the Social Security benefits, the Medicare benefits, that we can't look to government, that we have to look to ourselves and be responsible for ourselves. They don't want to say that. They want to get elected by promising a free lunch. Well you know, there's no more food left.
Larry, let me get your final thoughts on this, because we have seen something over the last couple of years with the financial crisis that consumers have been able to get their personal debt in check somewhat, not completely, but somewhat.
No question.
So is that a model? Can we say that the lawmakers will succeed in that?
That's right. Well, again, when we talk about the three pillars of the U.S. economy, we have government, certainly, which has been very late in getting its act together. But where there is hope here with reform that we can see some cost cutting and some difficult decisions. What we do see the other pillars of the U.S. economy, we see the consumer has been deleveraging. The savings rate is significantly higher today than it was a few years ago. Consumers are saving more. That may not be good for spending, but it is good for the consumer. It's good for their well-being. And the stock market is made up of companies. Companies today have the highest level of cash in 50 years as a percentage of asset. Companies are lean and mean. Again, not great for jobs, but good for the stock market because it produces strong profits.
I would disagree, though, that...
Well, we're going to have to leave it there.
I don't think the government is a pillar. I think the government is a barrier.
You know what? The stock market is about earnings, and earnings have been relatively strong despite all of our challenges.
Well, it's interesting because it's talking about the stock market, but we still have to talk about what's happening in D.C. We have to talk about what's happening on Main Street. And Sam, Peter, and Larry, great to have you all here for this conversation. It's one we're going to, I think, continue to have. It's something that's been pervasive in every single story that we cover, whether or not this is really a tipping point for this country. Thank you, gentlemen.